That was the only.
Sorry, I did not intend to throw it, and I was intending to wait. I just wanted to type it, and I didn't send it. That's stupid.
That's okay. That's fine.
That's cool. We're in here anyways.
Is there anything you guys want to get through before we start?
Nah.
Because I'm probably going to have to cut a bunch of shit from the opening of this now. Alrighty. Hey, everyone. Okay, let me do the quick math. So this episode 30 was the kids. 31 would be the mystery. 32 would be Sylum. I guess this is episode 33.
Nice.
That's crazy. Anyway, to the 33rd episode of the podcast. Here with us, Livy, Rev, and Shay.
Yeah.
Also have a bit of an announcement this week. A couple of announcements. By the time you're going to probably listen to this, it'll probably be week where, or the week before, we're Frostwalkers podcast are going to be on a live stream for Small Terrabona Dragonborn. They're doing an awesome charity event for Rainforest Alliance, and we're going to be doing an awesome one-shot up on their stream. Saturday. Oh, I should have had this pulled up. Okay, I'm talking through because I'm a DM and that's what I do. Okay, Saturday, October 12th at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we will be doing a special one-shot. Certain members of the cast, me and Rev, will be playing other games as well. I will be DMing on Sunday night, Claire Fantasia. So details are on our social media. We'll probably put up our individual cards in case you want to watch sessions that are in outside of the main cast. So that's one big announcement. Announcement number two, we are very soon going to have a new main cast member. You heard them a little bit ago, playing Valerin, but they're going to have a whole new character. Kat is going to be joining sometime after the interlude. And final precautionary measure, the Magic the Gathering set of Eldraine has just come out at time of recording. Like, not even paper cards are not able to be bought yet. So if anything isn't 100% up to the lore that's pre-written, sorry, question mark, it's our own. We're just using it as a backdrop. Anyway, those are all my little precursors. Anyone got anything else before we start?
No, I'm good.
Nope, I think that about covers it.
Alrighty. More information will come following weeks on social media. So stay tuned, and we're excited to see what comes next. Anyway, getting into the main episode, our session will open. Anyway, can you hear me better now?
Uh-huh.
Okay. All I was saying was that you guys are waiting for the red orb to be brought back to Timshel because Oletta, being a bureaucrat, kind of was like, we want to study it. And Kaelin was like, but we need that for resurrecting my friend. But, you know, politics.
Yeah, that's fair.
So
Did Kaelin explain to Oletta that that was what he was using it for?
In the background, probably he had to, because Oletta was holding it hostage in a lab. So Kaelin probably had to use, like, every bit of political goodwill to get this fucking orb back.
Yeah, probably.
Because, you know, the Sylum scientist probably wanted it, and he just... Kaelin had to pull every string he had to get the red orb back.
Yeah, that's probably correct.
Yeah. And so... He got you guys there for two reasons. One, because he wants to talk to you and have you there with the red orb. And two, because he low-key doesn't trust the people of Sylum and he's fully expecting a dud orb. And he's like, wouldn't they?
Oletta would not do that.
Okay, they wouldn't do it permanently. But, like, you can't tell me that they wouldn't set up a fake for, like, just an extra couple of days.
Sure. Okay, maybe for someone that they were afraid was going to way, but I think she trusts Kaelin.
That's fair. Still, Kaelin's being, like, just a little cautious after everything that happened in Sylum last time. So you guys have a little bit of time before the this airship is going to leave the Red Orb at the castle. What are you guys up to?
Should I go first or?
Yeah, what's your downtime just for a few minutes?
Okay, so Rowan did not go to Sylum with the rest of them. She was tasked with taking care of all the pets. We have many of them now.
I'm going to say Andre was with her because she also didn't go to Sylum.
Okay.
If that's okay.
They were both pet sitting.
Oh yeah, they were pet sitting. So Sari probably is like collecting her pets.
This is like a few days after the Sylum event, but yeah, okay.
She probably collected her pets, but like...
Fair.
You got to recover from that emotionally.
It's true.
Just so, Mr. Floofers chasing around Rowan and Rowan's poor cat.
Oh no. Yeah, so Luna's funny. Not very fast. She'd be very easy to catch.
I think, okay, I had a funny thought. What if they were chasing Filigree around at first, but because, you know, the added flight capabilities, that got real messy real fast, so Rowan and Andre were like, no!
My coffee maker! I always imagined Rowan as more of a tea person.
Andre's also a tea person.
There's probably some nice bonding between our druid and rogue, because they, back in episode 11, they were like, yeah, we need to talk more.
Oh yeah, that's nice.
Yay.
So you and Andre have had some nice time together to chill out, so I guess keep that in mind. Kalem would probably break up I'm just gonna say that the pets are here too, and you guys are just like catching up and playing with your pets.
Mm-hmm.
So Kalem's
we're having like a pet play date. That's cute.
Yeah, you're having a pet play date in the castle. Kalem just kind of pauses, puts his hand up and just like his finger up in the like give me a second, as this like rumbling sound comes from outside, and you hear him just kind of step out. He's like, I'm gonna go get that. It's the orb. I'll be right back. And he closes the door. So you guys have just like 30 seconds or so just with your pets. You gonna talk about anything without Kalem there? Oh, I will say Janice is like sitting in a rocking chair, like with a book.
Oh.
And he's just
what's the book?
Or does it matter? When I say with a book, he's not reading it. It's upside down and covering his face because he's trying to sleep.
No. Oh.
But it is a book of fairy tales.
That's a adorable. Yeah.
Is there any I will maybe Filigree's trying to climb Janice as he's sleeping.
She would.
Coco is probably just stomping around because they know this place. They were born here. So Coco's just happy as a clam. Mr. Floofers is probably, by this point, I think Mr. Floofers is more dog, less warg. Like, he is still a warg, but he acts like a dog.
Yeah, he's lost some of his kill instinct.
Yeah.
His feralness.
So he's probably, like, trying to jump up on Sari's legs the way, like, a little dog will, but they're huge.
Oh, buddy, you're crushing me. I miss you.
Cooper and Ernest are just kind of doing little circles in the air. It really looks like they're competing to see who can go fastest.
Aww.
And as Kalem kind of peeks back in with the orb, he just kind of looks at all the animals and just goes like, God, we run a zoo here, don't we?
Yes. Yes, we do.
Absolutely.
I mean, I appreciate, but I also don't. Andre, you feel a little like rub at your shoulder as your little mouse kind of peeks out.
Oh, hello there, Percy.
It gives you little, it like nuzzles your cheek.
Oh.
Aww.
But then it kind of looks at the orb, and you could just see like a little red flicker in its eyes as it stares at it. And then it just looks back at you and does a little nod.
Oh, like, I see.
It just seems kind of happy it's here.
Cool.
Kalem would probably like try and find a place to put it because he doesn't want to hold it in his hands. It's like, mm-hmm. It's not huge, but I'm imagining it takes both of Kalem's hands to hold it. I'm thinking like basketball size, you know?
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's a pretty sizely object, yeah. But that's because it's like a pure magic generator. It needs to be able to hold some in it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
As he kind of just is fumbling for a spot, you just see like Janice lift the book and just look at Kalem, just be like, just put it on my lap. And Kalem's like, okay. And you know, it thumps. And Janice just goes, oh, it's warm. Nice. Kalem turns to everybody and just goes, so, it's been some time. Woof. How do we even start?
Yeah. I mean,
between Sylum and all of our dreams about Anna, there's a lot on the table right now, isn't there?
Hmm. Do you guys ever need to talk about it?
Oh, I love
that's
her.
Kind of literally my job.
Yeah, I've mostly been telling everything to Cooper and Mr. Floofers.
Mr. Floofers likes your face.
Owen voiced my head, but he doesn't really know what to do with the other voice that's spoken to me in my head.
You just see the shadow on the wall just give a shrug. Kalem just looks, wow, your brother is like, I thought your brother'd be really useful with the whole ghost thing. Completely lost, huh? The shadow pantomime scratching its head and then shrugs again. It then just like pantomimes sitting up like on a chair and like putting up a newspaper. He's like, yeah, I guess we gotta be patient. It looks like it gives like Kalem a wink and then just kind of the shadow kind of spins in a circle and poofs out. Kalem just sighs and just goes, see, the thing is, you guys know how important this is to me. And we could go get the book, like, any given point. It's just the fact that Anna specifically said I need to be stronger.
What do you think that means, though? Because you're already like, do you need to go to the gym and work out and get really buff so that she can hug you with all your muscles?
I don't think that's what that is. Janice just kind of chuckles and just goes, even in the grave, she's a picky girlfriend, eh? She's not my girlfriend.
But yeah. Was she? Come on, you can tell me I'm your sister. Don't you love me?
Leave him alone.
I'm allowed to tease him.
We weren't together. I may have wanted to be, but we weren't.
Oh, Kalem.
And this just kind of chuckles and just goes, like I said. And the book of fairy tales flops to his lap and just goes, whatever. He then just kind of turns to you, Rowan, and just goes, so, you sure you don't got anything? Like, I mean, I figured, you know, life and death stuff would be your thing, even though I'm a druid too. I kind of am a druid in the sense that I do substances and tea. I'm not really into it, if that makes sense. Goes, Janice, we know.
I mean, I did have a very interesting talk with Basil. I know, surprising. I talked with Basil.
Yeah, how'd that go?
Really good, actually. Apparently, he and Throgmorton have been hanging out, and he's been kind of teaching him how to, I don't know, just interact with people, I guess. But yeah, we actually had a really interesting conversation. Dark magic is kind of Basil's thing, which explains a lot. And he was saying that it's possible that whatever created the Mausum could be either something very small and insignificant that we don't really have to worry about, or it could be very bad. Essentially, the Order of the Red Eye is a cult that exists, and if they have the power to create something like that, then it's definitely something that we should be worried about. But at the same time, it was still
colossally. Janice just kind of chimes in.
Well, yes.
Their leadership probably ain't that great if their plans sucked the way the Hags and the Mausum did.
It's true. They don't seem to be a very powerful cult. But that said, it does take a good amount of power to create something like the Mausum.
Yeah, broken clock strikes 12 twice. Broken clock's right twice. Caleb just kind of sighs and goes, I don't know if we can be that dismissive. It's around now that red light flashing from the orb, and Janice just goes, hey, Blue, this is really hot. What? Like, it shouldn't be this hot, right?
If it's hot, stop touching it.
It's on my lap, Rowan.
Get it off of your lap. It's not that hard.
Is anyone gonna do anything?
I'm gonna try to pick it up and take it off. Well, actually, that's stupid. Shoot, how do I get this off of him without, like, touching it with my hands? Do I have my staff?
Yeah.
Okay, can I try to, like, hit it off of him? With the staff?
You could try that.
Oven mitts? Okay, yeah, I'm gonna try to, like...
In this house, the oven mitts thing, and just fucking goes like, "I'll go grab some," and just starts running into the kitchen.
Okay, yeah, Rowan's gonna try to just like dink it off of his lap. Should I try to roll something for that?
Yeah, make an attack roll. Meanwhile, Andre, you see Percy is like tugging at your. Percy is like tugging at your hair right now as this orb is just glowing red.
What is it, Percy?
It just makes, like, rat noises and just keeps pointing its nose at the orb, like, look.
Dude,
look.
He's a familiar telepathic communication.
So, like, you just hear for the first time in a while, Percy just kind of, like, you see, like, his rat instincts kind of fade out for a second, and its eyes kind of glow orange, and you just hear in your voice, you may want to either step really close or really far. I don't know.
She just kind of shoots back. Well, which one?
You then just hear her, like, the weird voice of the telepathic link change for a moment. Just like, I don't know. And Andre, it's a voice you remember. I don't know. The orb has always been kind of a wild card.
Is this who I think it is?
It is. She's communicating to you through Percy.
That's really clever. Nice job,
thank you. Anyway, what the fuck? You could almost hear her pulling at her hair. Just like, this, the orb is supposed, yeah, the orb is unstable. Those eggheads. And you just hear, like, her grumbling to herself. Those people in Sylum must have done something to it.
Okay, so out loud, Andrea's gonna be like, everyone get away from the orb.
Janice is like,
no, I got an 18 to attack the orb and get it off of him.
Caleb, so at this moment, as you whack it, Rowan, Caleb runs in with oven mitts and is like, I got him, and you whack it, and you just hear Anna just go, oh shit. Andre, the last thing you hear is Anna go, oh shit, as the entire room is covered in red light.
Ooh.
The okay. magic innate in your staff, Rowan, in the brief moments allotted, you saw that the magic in your staff hit the orb, and well, now you're here. The red light, specifically, has just covered all of your field of vision. All you can see are your friends who are in the room. And Coco. The rest of the pets scampered off real quick. Actually, I'll say Floofers and Percy are there too. But the others kind of skedaddled as soon as the orb started going weird, you know?
Okay.
Cooper, you coward!
And as the light fades out, you're not in the castle anymore. You're in, like, a city square.
Oh, shit, it's Ravnica all over again.
Please tell me this isn't Ravnica.
Caleb just goes, it's way too... Caleb, after kind of blinking, looks around, just goes, this place is way too rustic. It's way too rustic. This looks like Timshel, just, you know, not.
Yeah, it looks different.
It's
like the same, but different.
To give you a very out-of-game explanation, you're standing in a very medieval town. Like,
so normal, because this is fantasy.
Like, more high fantasy than the fantasy you're used to. We're talking, like, Tolkien fantasy town looking, you know? Like King Arthur.
Again. More fantasy than our. You can never get enough fantasy.
You just hear, Andre, in your head, you hear, oh, so I think this time was. Oh no. Andre, we may have a problem. I think the distance between.
Anna?
I think the plane you're in is far from. You're not.
I can't tell if this is intentional or not, and I'm scared.
Oh, it very much is. You're. Oh, cool. Andre is getting half sentences. And static.
At this point, she's like muttering out loud, like, Anna? Anna, I can't understand what you're saying.
At the very end, you make out, like, right before
Are you okay?
You hear, like, you make out, you're on a different plane. I don't know what's happening. Don't worry about it. Keep the orb safe. Once it charges enough, I can maybe do something. You just gotta trust. And the line goes dead.
Andre lets out a very heavy sigh. Wait, what who was happened? It that asked if she's okay?
Rowan.
Okay. Andre will turn to Rowan. Just, actually, she addresses the group. Okay, so Anna was just talking to me through Percy, and she was the one who told me that we should back away from the orb, and then that happened, and I lost my connection with her. She says to keep the orb safe, because once it recharges, she might be able to do something to get us back to Timshel.
So we're not on the material plane anymore, are we?
It doesn't seem so, no.
Janice just kind of sighs and goes, well, where did we end up? As he's holding the Book of Fairy Tales still.
I don't know.
And at this point, there's the clattering of hooves as a cavalcade of knights appear in the city square. This is like, as you're looking around, this city square is very adorned in white. It's very like marble. It's actually very pretty. But these knights are in red.
I see. So they're not knights from here.
You can't be sure. But as this cavalcade of four knights kind of come and do this like motion of parting, two figures walk up in the middle of it, having already disappeared. And one of them is a girl with blonde hair in a very, like, distinct red hood. She has, like, full armor, though, a sword in her hand, and standing next to her is a boy with the same color hair and eyes and skin and a blue cape and the same metal armor. His sword glows blue. Hers doesn't glow. And as the two just kind of walk over to you and look you up and down, and the girl addresses you first, holding out a hand, and you could hear the metal of her armor chink as she does to Andre, and just go, "Well, hail and well met, traveler. You have seemed to have come from a long way. What's your name?"
I'm Andre.
Nice to meet you. My name's Rowan.
Nice to meet you, too. She looks between this new Rowan and her Rowan, and she's like, huh.
The boy kind of next to her just goes like, still has his arms crossed. He hasn't extended his hand yet, but you can hear him kind of mumble, "My name's Will."
Hello, Will.
Hi.
Nice to meet you as well. Question. Where are we exactly?
Ah, you're in Ardenvale. One of the five kingdoms of the realm.
In where?
You're far travelers, yes?
What travelers?
We'll go with that, yes.
Well, you've arrived on the world of Eldraine. It's not common that we find some folk like yourself. Calum just kind of looks at Janice and just goes, Did you let the orb touch the fairy tale book? And Janice just kind of goes, "You know, I was starting to think about that." Rowan and Will kind of eye the rest of you and just go, "Oh, I think it best we talk somewhere less public." And they kind of gesture you and just kind of lead you to follow as the four knights kind of ride in a circle around you and then basically provide flanking for you as they kind of start moving to the west of the city.
Okay.
What do you do? Will was really dead silent. Rowan seemed to be the more talkative one, but she did say, like, Will, she does tell you that they're going back to their camp, and there they can be a bit more open about certain things.
Okay. Yeah, I think I just follow them. Also, I made a joke earlier where I said that they were, Rowan and Will were my siblings. It was just because my siblings are blonde twins.
As you guys kind of march through the town, you hear the average hustle and bustle of a historic city. People are buying clothes. People are some knights are around in white armor. They're brandishing weapons, but they're mostly seeming to do it for show, you know? And in the center, if you look behind you, in the far distance is a very circular castle, very beautiful. And there are just a bunch of white banners everywhere. And there's some people talking. They kind of have accents to their voice. But you get the sense that this place is fairly densely populated for this world standard, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And there are musicians playing, something like this.
And we'll say sorry, immediately tries to learn this on her pipes.
Pick a wisdom check to see if you could pick up any of it.
Woohoo! That's a 21.
That's a what?
It's a 21.
Sorry, you get the melody very quickly, and you realize you can play it on your pipe.
Oh, you're a natural, Sarge.
She starts playing it. She's like, just nods very sagely as she continues to play it.
And so you follow the Kenrith twins as they make it into this small camp on the outside of town. Other Rowan gestures you inside this big tent, the biggest in the cavalcade. And as you guys kind of waltz in there, the twins look you up and down and just go, "So, now that we're in private, where are you from? Really, where are you from?"
Well, I was born somewhere. And then I live in the gnome village. And then I was raised in a monastery. Then I lived in...
We're from
Tim Shoals, where I live currently.
Yes, we're from Faerun.
Ah, well, we have yet to visit there in our travels. The two look at each other and kind of eye you and just go, "We are also far travelers, or planeswalkers, as they're known here. We don't do it very often, but we do have appearances to keep here in Eldraine, but we know that that is a power that exists, so..."
How many people are planeswalkers? Like, what a coincidence that we run into...
So many. There's so many.
Well, the statistic is about 1 in 1,000,000, but if you consider the vast reaches of the multiverse and the sheer number of people in one universe...
Yeah.
I guess.
It's not a big number, but it's not a small number.
Yeah, that's fair, I guess.
It seems like coincidence that we specifically run into you.
Well, call it coincidence, call it providence, what have you. Regardless, what brings you to Eldraine?
Complete accident, honestly.
We didn't do it on purpose.
Well, that is seemingly true for everyone's first time planeswalking. Will just kind of chimes in. We just discovered that we can do this, like, a week ago.
Where did you go?
We're not entirely sure. There was buildings, and there was. It seemed far more advanced than any world we've ever than in anywhere in Eldraine.
Did you see a squid lady?
We're not entirely sure, but we did. We did see a woman who looked very much like a tree.
You could have gone to the Feywilds, or maybe you went to Ravnica.
We're not entirely sure. We didn't stick around very long.
That's fair.
Will just kind of nods. We would have stayed and enjoyed the sights, but we can't necessarily be separated. Rowan just kind of sighs and just goes, "We don't need to bother them with the details, Will." "All right, look. Now that you're here, and until you leave, we may ask of your service. We are searching for something. Someone." There's a merfolk woman in a lake in a part of Eldraine known as the Wild. There are 5 kingdoms in Eldraine, and surrounding them are the wilds. That is a place where magic and the fae run rampant.
Rowan turns to Janice and just kind of, like, chuckles a little bit and is like, "Huh, sounds like your old stomping ground."
"Yeah, don't remind me."
Oh, sorry.
It's okay. Calum just kind of mumbles, "Oh, what do you need?" "There's a merfolk in one of the lakes, in one of the seas. Her name is Emrin, and our father requires something from her. If you can help us find Emrin, we will do everything in our power to make sure you can return safely."
I mean, it's not like we have much better to do with our time.
Janice kind of nods and says, "Plus, if we're dealing with a magic lady of the lake, That could be enough magic to get this thing to charge up again. He starts shaking the orb like a, you know, like one of those light up balls.
Maybe. Don't shake it. You don't want it to go off again. Even if it's not charged, I don't trust it.
We just immediately go somewhere else. Well, thanks for giving us the mission. Bye!
Caleb just kind of looks to them both and just goes, so are you guys... You're twins, right? You're related, yeah? The two nod and just goes, is that obvious? Rowan just kind of explains, the four knights you're surrounded by were knights from the kingdom of Embrith. They're accompanying us on this quest. This is actually one of our very first quests alone, so we're very excited. We've been training all our lives, but this is the first time we've really been given a quest.
Well, good news for you. We're experienced quest takers, goers.
Adventurers?
Yes.
Well, Rowan tries to take a like heroic stance, but she does not look very, very impressive.
Fair. The other Rowan looks and just goes, you may not have a very big stature, but you do seem to have a very big heart, so that may make up for it.
Aww, I like you, other Rowan.
Will just kind of looks over at Andre and just goes, so, what does your group do? Like, I mean, that sounds strange, but we've encountered people who have martial prowess, magical prowess. We just want to make sure we're not bringing along people who could get hurt. Rowan just kind of smacks her brother on the shoulder and says, they look ready. They look ready to fight.
We can hold our own. Yeah.
Yeah.
We've got some magic between us.
Well, that is interesting. Hopefully we can see some of it, but hopefully not in a dangerous context.
Danger seems to follow us around. So, hopefully.
That is fair. The wilds are a very, well, wild place.
Yeah. I can imagine.
Hello?
Hello? Did it just go silent for everybody else?
Yeah.
Rev?
I'm here.
B? Not again. B?
Hello?
There we go.
Yeah, for some reason my data is now searching, but my Wi-Fi is still working, so that's fine. Anyway, you notice it's about mid-afternoon. Okay. And Rowan and Will explain that they're going to be leaving for the wilds tomorrow. That's when the cavalcade is going. So you have some time, basically, to go back into the town in Ardenvale if you'd like to make yourselves blend in better. Is how Rowan puts it.
I feel like that might be a good idea.
All right. Well, we're not. You may not. You may not have the right currency. I don't know if that's. Don't worry about it. Well, put it that way. Don't worry about it. If you get into any trouble, when you ask, just tell them to put it on the tab of the Kenriths, and they'll understand.
Okay. Thank you for your kindness.
Just find some things that'll make you blend in better, because in the wilds, strangeness, while seemingly everywhere, is easy to notice.
Oh, I see. We're trying to camouflage ourselves like in the wild.
Well, more like trying to make yourselves look like you're from Eldraine.
So
okay, do the people of Eldraine dress differently than us? Because I mean, we are dressed like in, you know, kind of medieval-esque garb. Although we probably are in like these big sweaters. It's like starting to get into fall in Tinsel, right? There's probably a little bit of snow on the ground.
Yeah, the main thing is, yeah, a lot of it is similar, but like the clothes of the realm are very purposeful.
Mm.
So in Ardenborn, you'll get a lot of white. In Embrith, you'll get a lot of red. You get the picture?
Oh, I see. Okay.
Like, you know, there's not a lot of variance, I'll put it that way.
I see. Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah. So the Kenrith will kind of just let you go. They'll tell you to just, you know, make it back to camp in the evening, and they'll head off to the wilds tomorrow. So you guys have this little town in Ardenvale to explore. So where would you guys go?
Where is there to go?
It's your typical medieval town. There's clothing stores, there's a tavern, there's, you know. It's a bit smaller than Timshel, I'll admit. There's like a blacksmith. There's different things. It doesn't seem like they're very advanced in things of a magical nature, though.
Mm-hmm. Rowan's just gonna follow the others wherever they go.
The main thing you're looking for is clothes, admittedly.
Okay. Do you guys want to do that first?
Yeah, that works.
So where would you guys like go to get, like, what kind of clothing would you guys get in a medieval setting? Like, we're talking fairy tale high fantasy levels of outfit here.
See, B, I'm afraid you have preyed upon my one weakness, and that is high fantasy fashion.
A good weakness to have, truly.
A good weakness, but one that my wallet does not want me to have. Because it won't let me get the fancy dresses.
Fair.
But sorry.
But this is sorry. Can sorry afford a fancy dress?
Sorry, let me check how many gold pieces you have. What do you have in your wallet? What kind of jingle? Oh, she has 90 gold pieces. She can buy stuff.
Yeah. And don't forget, like, you can kind of go nuts. The Kenriths basically are telling you to, like, they'll cover you.
Ooh, okay.
Okay.
I'm thinking.
Let's see.
I feel like you've given three artistic people choices in their in fashion.
Mm-hmm.
So this that makes
sense. Point.
Cool medieval, like, assassin outfits, Google, please.
Yeah, basically. But.
I'm thinking something kind of similar to Snow White's dress, like puffed sleeves and the flowy skirt, but the skirt's a bit shorter so that she can still like run and kick stuff.
Cute.
I love it. Yeah, you'd probably find something like that here. Ardenvale is very formal.
Yeah, cute. She gets it in more like neutral tone colors so that it doesn't look as princessy fancy.
That's fair.
Mm-hmm. It's like a similar style. Yeah, I think that, I mean, we are going to be like traipsing through the woods, right?
Yep.
We're going to the wild. So I feel like we're probably trying to find something practical, but there's that part of her that also like wants to wear something pretty. So I think she'd probably find like a nice little like green dress, mm-hmm. that's like I wouldn't say like fancy, but like has some nice little like lacy decorations on it. You know, it's like a cute. She feels very cute. But then she'd probably also like make sure that the bottom of it wasn't too long, so that she could just wear pants and like boots underneath it. But she still has to be able to like run around.
Yeah.
So it's not like a big fancy dress. She's not wearing like, there's no like hoop skirt or anything like a lot of fantasy dresses. It's just like a casual dress and then pants. And
that's fair. Okay.
Valid.
Andre?
I think Andre will do everything in her power to not wear a dress. So, I'm kind of thinking like something kind of like Robin Hood-esque, like kind of like medieval archer kind of thing. I don't know how best to put this into words.
See, now that I'm like really thinking about it, I'm like, she could and would almost entirely wear something more similar to like Peter Pan.
Oh, okay.
Andre or Sorry?
Like Sorry. She would consider the dress forever. And then she would see like a cool tunic-y top and like the leggings and the hat.
Oh my god, what was that?
I don't know.
And I think the hat would sway her. Because we know, Sorry is a hat person.
Fair. Okay, I love it. I dig that. I dig that immensely. Okay.
Cool.
So it seems like Andre's going Robin Hood, Sari's going Peter Pan, and Rowan is kind of...
Yeah, like not really princess, but like a cute dress and then pants underneath it.
Okay, so like almost like very fantasy druidy.
Yeah,
like the women in the woods kind of druid.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah, kind of nymph like.
I like it. Evocative. I dig it. I will say that Kalem has very like, I guess the best way to put them would be very like typical protag robes. You know what I mean? Like
he looks like Deku in the fantasy episode of My Hero Academia.
I wish I knew that episode so I can kind of.
I wish I knew what you were.
Do you want me to send you a? I'll send you a photo.
But like I was thinking more like.
God. Sorry, I just saw what Libby posted and it's making me laugh.
But like, you know the typical look that like young fantasy boys have, like the Black Cauldron kid and you know.
Yes, I know exactly what you're talking about because that's what I draw every character in.
So like that, very much that.
Good. I don't have to change any of my art.
Janice probably went like in a similar vein, but his is like just a bit more flashy.
Cool. Mm-hmm.
So you guys look Eldrainian. How do you feel with your new duds?
I feel Eldrainian.
I feel cute. She's twirling around in her little dress.
Janice says, "You are cute."
Aww.
He gives him a little kiss on the cheek. He has to lift her up or bend down, but it's fine.
Or she scales him like
climb your boyfriend. It's weird.
Hang on, just let me just scurries up. There you go.
like the way that like a kitten does.
Yeah, exactly.
That's weird.
But at the same time, the funniest visual.
What was I gonna say? Yeah, you guys managed to do that. And is there anything else you'd want to look into? Like, the clothes was sort of the main deal, but is there, like, anything else just you're kind of curious about?
Ooh, Rowan's wondering how the food is here.
Yeah, okay.
You would. She's adventurous. She likes to track food in new places.
Okay. Would you guys follow Rowan to get some food?
Yeah. Zara's kind of hungry.
Food's good.
Okay.
Mom, I'm just hungry.
Again, the fact that you've put it on the tab of the Kenriths has... I didn't really mention that. When you told them to put it on the Kenrith tab, the people kind of chuckle, and then Caleb's like, no, we're serious, and they're like, okay, you know. And they did it, and, you know, they seem to honor that. And the same deal goes for the food, and when you say that, they like... They don't really tell you what they're going to make you, but they do inform you that it'll be good. And
okay, we're going to, like, surprise.
Here's kind of an example of what the food in Eldraine could look like.
Oh.
Ooh. Whoa, interesting. Yummy. That's like a whole pig. Whoa.
Have you... Okay.
It's funny that you mention it, because for the non-MTG inclined, Eldraine just introduced the new token type, and it is food. So they had artists like actually draw fantasy food for this set, and so I just found it really hilarious that Rowan wanted to eat, because he's just like, actually, there's literal art of what the food in Eldraine is.
Oh my god, you're making me hungry, oh my god.
Oh
my yes. goodness.
There's like pastries and apples and ham.
Oh my god, Rowan's in heaven. She's eating everything.
Sari is joining her. She is eating everything.
Anjay's probably showing a little bit more restraint, but she too is impressed and she is eating.
Janice is eating less fucking tactfully than even Rowan or Sari.
I don't believe
Janice me. Is eating like he's never eaten in he's hasn't eaten. Oh, I understand now. It's because of the weed. He's got the munchies.
I hate that, but you're not incorrect. And of course, what fantasy setting wouldn't? Your meal ends with a pie, just apple pie.
Mm. Look at those spiral bananas. That's weird. I love it.
How would you peel that? How would you peel and eat that?
You probably have to break into pieces. Not gonna lie.
No, that's not how you eat bananas.
So would you guess that you're full?
Can I roll for fullness?
Absolutely. Andre, what were you kind of like leaning towards with the eating? There was like ham, there was some quail eggs and some quail themselves, pastries, fruits. Like what was Andre's muse at the dinner table?
Sorry, let me.
I was gonna say I got a 15. Am I full?
You are like, you maybe ate a little too much, but you're very happy. But it's like that level of eating too much where you're not like sick. You're just like aware of the fact you ate too much, but you don't care, you know?
Hmm. That happens every time I eat Asian food.
Same.
It's not like sick full. It's just like very satisfied full, you know?
Mm-hmm. Okay, good.
Okay, so as for what Andre kind of ate, her first instinct would be to go for the pastries because she's got she's got a sweet tooth. But she's gonna like refrain and like eat, I don't know, some of various meats first, I guess. I don't know, because my girl's pretty practical. She's like, I don't know what we're about to face, so like, I don't want to shove my face full of sugar. She does indulge in a few pastries, though, when she's done.
Yeah. There's probably a point where you and Janice both reach for a pastry, and he's just like, I'll get another one. And he ends up grabbing two.
Rowan is not eating anything in, like, any particular order. She's just kind of grabbing things and eating them. Like, that's how halflings do.
Croissant followed by ham, followed by apple.
Yeah, she's just eating everything. It's not, she's like neat about it. She's like, she's not being impolite. She's just eating a lot of food.
Calum is very,
not in any order.
I think Calum is like very much interested in the ham for a while and then goes for a few pastries, but you notice he kind of doesn't touch a lot of the fruit. And he just kind of goes like, it's a fairy tale. I don't trust fruit.
The apples might be poisoned. But,
there is a moment where one of them goes like, would you like your egg gilded?
What?
Gilded, you know, from a gilded goose.
What?
Oh my god, you have a goose that lays golden eggs.
We have golden geese that lay golden eggs. Consistently.
Oh. My. Gods.
They're the gilded goose. They're everywhere.
Yes, of course. I knew that.
Oh yes, I have three at home. They're lovely.
These two humans who are feeding you are just kind of chuckling, and they're just like, you must not be from Arden Vale. It's fine. I understand. The five kingdoms must be very different from each other.
Yes. Exactly. Quite.
I think Rowan and Andre have eye each other, sweat a little bit, turn back.
Oh, I will say, he cast Minor Illusion on himself to give himself a normal skin tone.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Because
does he still have green hair?
Huh?
Does he still have green hair?
Janice? Janice? Okay, here's what Janice.
Well, yeah, because Rowan and... Sorry, not Rowan. Calum and Janice both kind of have unusual...
Right. Janice minor illusioned his skin, but just the sheer enjoyment of what's going on caused him to go from his spring form to autumn. So his hair is like a red, which is fine, normal.
Cute.
He just had to illusion the leaves to look like hair.
But I'm gonna have to draw like human Janice.
He's sort of fair skinned in this form, but he has like very very like autumnal red hair.
He sounds adorable. I've never wondered what Janice looks like. That's really cool. I'm gonna have to draw them now.
As you guys are just finishing up your dinner, the two chuckle and just go like, but really though, are you actually on the tab of the Kenriths?
Yes.
Yeah, we are. Yeah.
No, the are you referring to the Kenrith twins or their father? Because if you're on the... Then we may not even ask you to pay. We wouldn't want to bother one of the kids of Eldraine.
Oh, shoot. Andre just kind of, like, looks at the party and is just, like, back at this person. And she's just like... We're on the twins tab.
Friends of the young prince and princess. All right.
Yes, that's us.
You honor their word. You are a very interesting lot, but you know, when it seems that they keep interesting company, so I suppose that makes sense. I heard about their trek to the wilds. I do wish you well.
Thank you.
Strange things lie in the wilds. Elves, fairies.
Yes, elves are in the wilds and not in this room. Not at all.
Rowan just kind of like slowly covers her little pointy ears. Because like halflings still have little pointy ears.
Yeah. Andre does have her hood up to hide her ears.
The two chuckle and just be like, yeah, that would be funny if any elves, if any of the wilds folk actually managed to make it into the realm. Except for maybe one of the realms, I suppose, makes more sense. But, you know, we try our best to accommodate all folk here. It's just uncommon.
Slowly.
We don't intend to sound prejudiced in any way. We're sure the wilds run their things differently for reasons, but... You know, they just tend to not be interested in the ways of the people of the realms, and you know that's all right. We're not going to force them to do something, and they're not going to force us to do something. So we will just be happy where we are.
Nice, I get.
What? Oh yeah. The only elf we know of is Ayara. She's one of the leaders of one of the realms. She came from the wilds, but rose up to political power in Lochthwain. But here in Ardenvale, we serve Queen Lyndon, the wife of King Kenrith. You might actually have what they probably have like a post, like not a poster, but like a very nice art piece of Queen Lyndon, on like one of the walls, you know, to show their allegiance and stuff like that, you know. And she's a very proud looking queen. She's tall for, yeah, just tall in general. Very beautiful dark hair, very ornate dress. She has darker skin. And opposed a golden outfit with a lot of whites and silvers.
Ooh, pretty.
This just sounds beautiful.
She does. She sounds lovely.
You can check the text chat, actually.
I'm pretending for the viewers.
Yes,
imagination. Oh, wow. Oh, wow, that's a really cool dress.
Because she looks beautiful.
Whoever designed that, good dress design. Very cool. Very unique.
Applause to you, person.
So, the only other poster...
Random MTG artist.
The only other, like, main art you might find is that of Kenrith himself, who is a fairer-skinned man with blonde hair and a facial hair. Much more plain. But all record of him have the term the Returned King all over them. The two humans who have been feeding you, probably a man and a woman, would probably explain to you that Kenrith had went missing, and it was Rowan and Will who discovered their, and that was their first big adventure that began their lives as questers, adventurers. Queen Lyndon is also their adopted mother, but no one treats it that way, you know? Anyway, those two like very formal pieces are on the wall. There's probably also just like art of like, you know.
Oh wait, did you mean stepmother?
Yes. Yeah. Queen Lyndon is their stepmother.
Ah, I see.
But that's what you would gather from this restaurant and from the gossipy people there. As the night ends, you would probably return to Rowan and Will. And what would you do when you see them again? I'll say that the knights have probably gone to bed, and Will is trying, but Rowan is seemingly excited for tomorrow's events. So what would you tell them before you... When they see you, actually, Rowan would probably be waiting outside and just be like, oh, you're back. I like the new outfits. Very, very nice. She does look Andre up and down for a second and just goes like, huh, I respect the hood. And she kind of puts up hers.
Thank you.
You look ready to be a knight of Embrith.
A knight, huh?
Yeah. Eldraine works a little different. There, you can achieve knighthood in each of the five kingdoms. My father has actually managed to achieve knighthood in all five kingdoms of Eldraine. My mother only four.
Yes. Oh. Speaking of that, you didn't tell us that you were a princess.
That we were. Oh.
I see. You know, royalty.
It turns people off. We don't want people to be our friends just because we have money.
I'm debating saying a thing. Should I roll for it?
Yeah, I guess so, if you want.
Okay. That doesn't really help me. That's like right.
Oof.
Okay. Yeah, I'll say it. I gesture to Caleb, and I'm just like,
well, if it makes you feel any better. Back from where we're from, he's a friend. We're all friends with him. But we don't mind.
Caleb kind of chuckles and goes, they're my council. They've helped me through a lot. Rowan and Will, not having friends is useful.
The only reason I rolled for it was because I didn't know I wanted her to, like, make a call-out post to him.
Yeah, no, I getcha. As you guys would go to bed, Will explains to you that even though the kingdom of Eldraine is even though Eldraine is separated from five courts in the realms, the five courts work together. So that's why people from Ardenvale are comfortable with people from different courts, but the wilds are separate from everybody on purpose, you know? Mostly by choice, but people sometimes wonder, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But the five kingdoms cast of are Ardenvale, Vantress, Lochthwain, Embrith, and Garenbrith. And Will would explain to you that Embrith is the kingdom of courage. They're like where a lot of knights come from, you know? They're passionate, idealistic, a little bullheaded, good soul. Garen Brig is the kingdom of strength. They're naturalistic. They believe in their communal nature and the wild.
I think that if asked, Rowan would say that she's from.
Okay. Yeah, it's the green aligned kingdom. Vantress is the kingdom of knowledge. It is where all the mages study. And the only other two, Ardenvale, you've been in, are known as the kingdom of loyalty. And Lochthwain, where Ayara is queen, is the kingdom of persistence. but Lochthwain is the. But there is a way in from Ardenvale. So their plan is to wake up in sunrise and head into the wild. And the Red Knights Embrith, but that's because they were more encouraged about the idea of going into the wilds, whereas Knights of Ardenvale may have been stringent.
Mm-hmm.
And since this was kind of an on-the-fly quest, they kind of had to go with the people who were braver than bit more I didn't count.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Rowan kind of has conversations. Well, you all should get your rest. Tomorrow will be an interesting day for sure. of luck to you. And we'll time skip to the morning. You guys had a tent. The Kenrith set up a red tent for you. It was probably cramped, but it was the best they could do, you know, on mm-hmm. such this. So you may not have had the most peaceful night's sleep, unfortunately, because you were suddenly camping, you know.
Fine.
Does anyone need beauty sleep? Is that like, is that going to affect anybody having a bad night's rest?
Well,
nah, Rowan likes camping.
So, that's this is fair. Good.
Andre?
Andre can sleep wherever. She kind of had to learn to do that, so.
That's fair.
She's good.
Janice is used to sleeping in the wild. It's probably only Caleb who tossed and turned for a while.
Aww.
Even though he does camp out with Sari on the way to Abix's house. Mm-hmm. When you wake up in the morning, though, as you see Castle Ardenvale in the distance as you enter these thick woodlands, the world around you of the river kind of fades away as you see...
How many seas thick?
It's dense foliage, okay? very pretty trees... I would argue that you could get lost here, but Janice is an outlander, and so the Kenrith's map means that Janice can basically nail the way to the lock.
Cool.
Yeah, outlander's ability is wanderer, which means so long as they've seen a map or know a rough idea of the geography, they can get you where you gotta go.
Cool.
So great. Janice holding the orb is actually kind of your... leading the pack for you guys, even though the Knights of Embrith are far ahead with the Kenrith twins in the far front, then Janice, and then your little group.
Okay.
There's probably two Knights of Embrith in front and two in the very back, you know, perimeting you.
Okay.
Okay.
And for most of the day, you're just kind of walking and talking. Is there, like, anything that would come up during your little hike before you make it towards about the evening? Or is there just, like, is Sari still, like, cartwheeling around instead of walking?
Oh, yeah, totally. That's Sari's whole jam, is cartwheeling, walking. Oh. Walking's for lame.
Rowan is delighted. She wants to try to cartwheel with you. Rowan Kenrith. I'm not gonna force shaded cartwheel.
My Rowan actually looks to Sari and just goes,
how do you not get dizzy doing that?
It's really easy. You just don't.
Okay, Rowan, I get
with a 22 to cartwheel.
Yay! Oh wow.
You learned how to cartwheel. Good job.
She's fucking nailing it, Sari. She's like cute. She's not as fast as you, but she's as consistent.
Good.
Would Sari be semi-threatened by another master cartwheeler, or would it be like, yes, more?
She'd be like, yes, cartwheel friend.
she would actually chuckle a bit and just be like, you are a very, very fun host. I almost kind of regret the fact that someday soon you're going to have to depart from Eldraine. I would love to accompany you more. But, you know, we did make a deal. And we honor our word, right, Will? He just kind of mumbles, yeah, whatever.
Mm.
Is Will the edgy twin?
Oh, Rowan just goes, Will has always been that way. He has a kind heart, don't get me wrong. It's just kind of cold. Why?
He's me then.
Yeah, I was actually going to say that Rowan actually kind of looked to Andre and
Will just kind of goes,
what's that for, Rowan?
Oh, nothing.
Squints.
Will just kind of looks at Kenrith Rowan and just goes like, why did you have to do that? And Rowan is dying with laughter. She's like, come on, it's funny. It's not funny.
But it's funny.
You don't even know why it's funny.
I don't, but it's funny.
Will just kind of sighs and puts his hand on his sword and it kind of covers in ice.
Oh no, please don't freeze my insides.
No. I was explaining the joke. I'm a cryomancer.
Oh, I thought you were gonna...
Hey, so is he! She points to Caleb.
Hi. You know ice magic? Yeah. Cool. I notice you, the way you hold a sword. Are you like a traditional knight, or... Rowan just kind of chuckles. Will fights like a coward. I'm joking, of course, but he's a bit more, how shall we... he's not a bullheaded assault. He's a tactical stab, if that makes sense. He's a tactician, not a knight. And he goes, like, you say that like it's a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. We've talked about this. You're useful to the group. You're very important to me and everyone here. Without you, I probably would have died 100 times. Glad we can admit that. Rowan just kind of chuckles and goes, I'm Spark Mage. She holds out her hand and lightning kind of sparks out of it.
Ooh, cool.
And Will just kind of chuckles. He just goes, yeah, she's also a massive hothead. Rowan just kind of sighs and just goes, come on. You gotta give me some credit. I did kill that troll last week. Yeah, you also found the troll last week. It's not my fault. There were some billy goats, and I wanted to follow them. Janice just looks at Rowan and just goes, why are they so dysfunctional?
They're siblings.
Yeah.
Tell me about it. I love you, sorry.
Aww. I love you too, buddy.
I've just been buddied. Oh no.
Buddy, bro, kiddo.
Buddy, friend, pal, chum.
As the day weans on to the nighttime hours, you realize that there isn't... It's still just woods. There's no real clearing to make camp. And as you keep going, Rowan just kind of does that thing that everyone does after you've walked for way too long, where they, like, you could tell they want to say something, but they're not, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But they're just really...
Are we there yet?
Thank you! Oh my god! We are on the same wavelength, Rowan.
Well, no, I was joking. Oh. But I wasn't gonna have Rowan actually say that, but if it's funny, I will have her say that.
I think if you did, Rowan Kenrith would just be like, oh my god, thank you.
I think she wouldn't. I'll say that Rowan does say that. She doesn't say it the way that I said it. I think she'd be a bit more polite. You know? Just kind of like when we getting there?
Rowan kind of just be like, that's my question exactly, Will. I'm trying. Andre, do you want to, like, I know you're a stealthy type. Would you like to make, like, maybe a stealth or perception check? If you want to scout ahead.
Ooh, yeah, she'll do that.
Okay, so roll me perception.
Okay, can do.
I'm trying to cut to the next scene.
Alright. Let me see. Perception?
Mm-hmm.
That is 14 plus 6, so dirty 20.
Andre, you noticed it before anyone else? That all the woodlands lead to this one specific clearing that has a home that doesn't look like it's made of home. It looks edible.
Oh
this
my god.
Home is not made of home.
Oh my god. Oh my god. Wait. Can I also roll perception?
Well, you don't really need to. Andre would notice it just moments before everybody else. But what would you... Andre, you do have a second to say something, though.
I feel like if they notice in a few seconds anyway, all she like says is just whoa.
And you all see it. It's a home that looks like it's made of either gingerbread or a pie.
The house is made of cookies.
I know we all just ate, but oh my god. When are we ever going to have this opportunity again?
Can I lick the windows? Caleb.
Yeah.
Let's not turn out like Hansel and Gretel and be locked in the house and cooked in the oven. But can we eat the chimney?
Oh god, it's tempting. There's a chuckle behind you as this voice just goes, you could come in for some pie, like. And there's an old woman.
No thanks. We just want to eat your chimney and then we'll be on our merry way.
Can I roll insight and see if she has any ulterior motives?
You can. Yeah,
we don't freaking trust this old lady.
You can roll insight.
We've dealt with hags before. We're on to you.
Eighteen.
Oh yeah. Oh fuck yeah. This is you're in a fairy tale plane and there's an old woman with a gingerbread hat. You didn't even need to roll inside in kit, you know, like out of character. You knew some shit was up. Yeah, some shit's up.
She wants to eat us. Okay, bye.
Yeah, we're gonna not go there. Let's go the opposite direction.
Yeah, we're all just like, see you later. We leave.
The old woman's just like, I can make you some apple pie.
No, we're good.
No, I'm actually allergic to apples. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Will are giving you weird looks because this is normal to them. Like, what's wrong?
You know, I suddenly decided that I don't want to eat your chimney, so I'll be on my way. Bye.
Peace out. Very confused.
The lady just goes, are you sure you're sure?
Yes.
Yeah, we're pretty sure, yes.
All right. I suppose that's okay. I guess I gotta go back inside. Guess I gotta go make myself some pie.
If you're trying to make us feel bad, it's not working. It's not working, is it, guys?
It's not. Yeah. No.
Would you like me to get out an apple?
Does she look like this?
No, not yet. She's a creepy old lady, though.
Okay.
You know, I'm actually allergic to apples. Yeah, I've got this thing. I'm so severely allergic to the apple blossoms that the stuff in the apples makes me all sniffly and sneezy and hives from the juice. Oh, it's a terrible business. You wouldn't want it.
That's same. That's what my apple allergy is like. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's just chicken.
I'm allergic to apples. I just don't like them.
No lie, that's what happened to my brother. He eats apples.
Let me just... Yeah, Janice rolled a 5. Also, you're probably like an evil hag, just...
Oof. Janice, ever heard of tact?
Thanks, Janice.
Dude.
He rolled a 5, I'm sorry.
This is the man I've chosen to date. Why have I done this?
The old woman just kind of looks at Janice. It's like, oh, so we're doing this then. Did I say the wrong thing?
Janice,
wide-eyed look of like, yes, you did.
This old lady just kind of laughs a little bit and then looks over to the knights and to Rowan and Will, and they're just like, we're sure, but certainly these powerful, strong men love to rest their weary arms from all this armor. And the knights look at each other and go, are we being hit on by a hag? And she's like, I'm sure you fine gentlemen would love just to stick around here for an hour or so. And you could see, like, since you guys are super onto this lady, you guys can totally see her moving her hands and start casting.
Oh, she's trying to charm them.
Mm-hmm. Like, you could totally pick up on it. Like, it's super obvious to you, but the knights are just kind of like... Rowan and Will are so kind of onto it, you know?
Mm.
They're just looking at you guys like, is this lady for real? It's like, fine. I suppose you win. I won't give you food, but I will get some pie out of the affair. And she like,
No, you won't.
And just kind of like looks back at you and just goes, oh, I think I will. Come time for dinner, boys. And there's a skittering sound in the trees and in the woods.
No.
Oh, shit. Oh, no.
Just no. No.
Feel a hit. You hear this hiss. That is a... You're getting like 30 episodes ago. As these, like, sectoid hisses just kind of start coming from the trees.
Oh my god, does she have mean look?
And if these creatures appear and they just kind of...
Oh, they are mean look. Fuck.
No.
I thought we were done with this. Okay, Rowan takes out a heart mender.
The old woman just kind of chuckles and just looks at the knights and just... I'm sure even just one of Harry, lovely. Well, yes, it's time to see. And she kind of hits her staff on the ground. Knight, and they kind of start jumping at them. And the knights will be engaging in their own separate combat. As three of them are a lady who starts looking ready to start casting some spells at you. So... in this blast from the past, you guys are initiative.
Cool.
I'm sorry, but I'm really not.
Oh, we know. We know.
Okay, so you're gonna do second? Could you repeat those numbers again?
I got a 14.
Rowan got a 14. Sorry, Andre?
17.
Okay. Sorry.
I'm sorry. That's a 7.
Okay. So 14, 7, and 13?
14. Oh, wait.
No, I'm asking what Revs was one more time.
Wait, what?
Rowan had a 14. Andre had, sorry, had a 7. What did Andre get?
Hello?
What was Andre's initiative?
Oh, 17. Sorry.
It's okay. Okay, so top of this order is Andre.
If only she were an assassin. But alas, she is thief.
There are a and a hag. And they want to make you into pies. That a cheery.
Sweetie.
Okay.
Please don't make us into pie.
So wait, are the mean lock things like close to us?
Yeah, they're the mean lock are gang.
Okay.
I'm trying to stay back.
Okay. I'm gonna draw a Fearbringer. And make a stab at one, I guess.
Okay.
Yeah.
So stab a moonlock. Roll the hit.
All right.
Interesting, because the last time you fought them creatures, you were like level 3. You guys are like 5 levels higher now. I want to see I'm kind of curious to see how so much better you are now.
That is... Oh, yeah. Does a 23 hit?
Yeah.
Okay, sneak attack, yes or no? I can't understand what you're saying.
Yeah. Hold on. Going. Yeah, it's sneak attack for sure. And okay. Don't forget the buffed up Fearbringer is now a d6 instead of a d4.
Yep. Alright.
And you could do any of your charge abilities at any given point.
Yee. So that...
This is going to be either really funny or, like, really funny. Like, it'll be either really funny because you guys are still going to have trouble with these creatures that are CR2, or really funny because this won't last longer than 30 seconds.
Alright, so let's see. The D6 for initial damage, that's a 3. I have 4d6 sneak attack. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's a 4, 2 sixes, and another 4. So, hold on, 3, 4, 7, 13, 19, 23 damage.
23 damage. Okay, 23, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The speed lock is down to 8 hit points.
Nice.
Sweet.
So you just like gut this mean lock.
Oh.
I told you this was going to be an experience in irony. Next up is going to actually be Rowan Kenrith, who sees Andre's just badassery at this mean lock, and she is going to like run up to the one that's kind of trying to flank Andre. And she's going to go with her longsword. And. Okay, let's see how this goes. That's probably going to hit. That's a 14 plus 7. Damn. And she's going to add Divine Smite. So. It's going to be 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, plus 2, 8. Yeah, okay, she just fucking decimates another mean lock. This isn't... Like, she has this other mean lock with one slash.
Fantastic. Beautiful. Amazing.
It is bleeding, for sure. Next up is... Sorry.
Alrighty. Mean locks again.
This is a lesson to you about the way that D&D works, because these were scary at episode 3.
And now they're just dumb babies.
They're fodder.
Yep. So, sorry, though.
It's also a lesson to me about what level you guys are at, really.
Yeah. So, Sari has evolved as a character.
Yes.
And can now cast spells.
That is correct.
She's going to cast Thunder Wave.
Okay. So it's going to be the 3 mean locks and the Night Hag to make con saves?
Yep.
Right? Okay. And what's the number?
13.
Okay. Mean lock number 1 rolled a 7. Number 2, an 18. Number 3, a 5. And the Night Hag rolled a 17. So 2 mean lock are going to take the full brunt. 1 Night Hag and 1 mean lock are going to take half. Unless the number to beat is 17.
Mm-hmm. It's just 13 is the DC.
Okay, so 2 of them are taking full. Are you going to hit the ones that have already been damaged with the full damage of the Thunder Wave?
Yep, and then I'll just divide it in half for the other 2.
Okay. So,
10... So that's 10 thunder damage. So the other 2 take 5.
Okay. So One of the Meemoks is already dead. One of them is very close.
Yeah, that's right.
One of them is all right. And the hag looks... they look okay. Okay. It's going to now be a weird portion of the part where Kalem and Will Kenrith are going to go back to back. So I'm going to just kind of have them do the thing at the same time. So Will Kenrith is going to hit with a longsword. And they're also going to get sneak attack. So that's going to hit. That's going to be... Hold on. 11. Okay, so Will does 15 points of damage to one of the Meanlock, killing it.
Nice.
So there's one Meanlock in the hag already. And Caleb's just kind of looking at everyone like, do I even need to be here? But he's gonna ice knife one of the Meanlocks. It's like, no, this is too uncomfortably close. It hits. It's gonna take 7 points of cold damage, and then it needs to make a dex save, which it fails. Then... Fuck! That d12 was an 11! Okay. 18. This other Meanlock is, like, also about to die.
Cool.
Good.
That said, Rowan, you're up.
Which Rowan?
Okay.
Rowan, who's a Rowan the halfling.
Yes. Okay. I'm going to I'm going to use call lightning.
Okay.
I'm gonna lightning one of them.
The Meanlock or the hag? Because the hag has taken very little damage, and this other
actually, the hag. I'll target the hag.
What kind of saving throw is that?
Rowan has a trend of killing hags with lightning, so.
What kind of saving throw is call lightning?
I think it's. Dexterity?
Yeah, it's dex. Yeah. Does a 14 beat?
No, it does not. It's my spell save is 6.
Roll 3d10s of lightning.
Oh yeah. Yes.
These guys haven't gotten to hit yet.
That's a 2. It's a 9.
Mm-hmm.
7. Mm-hmm. So.
That's 18.
Yeah, 18.
Okay. She's not looking great, I'll tell you that much. Now it's Janice's turn. And seeing you do that, Rowan, he just goes like, good job, Pink. He's going to do the same thing. The hag fails again. He's going to take 4, 7.
Take that, witch.
16 points of damage. Yeah, this hag is already, like, bloody.
Good.
And now she and the one surviving Meanlock can actually do things. Whoa. After being fucking completely decimated. One of them's gonna try and claw at Sari, the Meanlock.
Okay.
Oh my god. Does a 10 hit?
Let me just... You know, no, it doesn't.
I figured it. Okay, the hag is gonna look at Andre and say that she's gonna say that your hood absolutely does not match your eyes, and you need to make a wisdom saving throw for vicious mockery.
What?
Me?
Show you that outfit.
A wisdom save, you said. Oh, wow. Andre, baby, why?
Oh, no.
That one.
Oh, no. You're offended.
She's offended. Excuse me. I'll have you know.
Disadvantage next round.
You take how many points of damage?
Two.
Okay.
You forget Vicious Mockery is a fucking D4.
Yeah.
That's yeah. funny.
Yeah, this is just a lesson in tragedy, really. This hag is, like, really certain that they're gonna die, you know? So they look over to the fight with the knights as these Meanlock are jumping them, and they've held their own. There were 4 knights. One of them went down, but all their Meanlocks are dead, so there's only 3 knights in your court left. The hag, seeing the situation, just kind of goes like, you know what? I don't want to die, so I think I'm gonna, like, save my pies for some other time. All right, y'all, I'm gonna head out. And as she starts, like, backing up to her house, Rowan and Will are like, this was sad. This was almost not a fight. And the hag's just like, what, you want me to fight harder? Like, what do you want from me? I'm an old lady. What do you want?
Maybe, like, don't eat kids. Maybe, like, try some fruit pies, maybe. I hear that they're way better than children.
There's a voice up in the trees now that just goes, eh, yeah, that's fair, but I also figure, like, you know, it's the wilds, man. They can do what they want.
No, eating children is not okay.
Eating people's not good.
Says you.
Says most people.
Okay. You know what? Next time, we'll just let him eat.
Yeah.
We'll just let the lady eat you, okay?
This is the guy up in the trees, by the way. He's got blue and white skin, black hair, like a crown made of, like, wood on his head, like a pelt on his back that does not cover his chest, because of course it doesn't, and bare feet and, like, some pants, and he looks very fey.
We'll just let the scary witch lady eat you then.
I don't think they do that. I don't think they do that, because you see, I'm here. I'm all about them living their best life, you know? Right. You know Auntie Slumgood? The hag just kind of mumbles and goes back into their house. It's like, fuck you, Oko. Like, look, me, I'm not gonna, you seem like a group of busy people. I'm not gonna bother you if you don't bother me. I'm just here to let you know, the wilds are a different place. You gotta, like, it's one of those get with it or die sort of situations. just gotta get with it. Get with the time.
No. This guy.
She's like, everyone should just do whatever they want. You know? Like, here these two royal nitwits are, children of a king, and their whole lives are governed by rules. If I had it my way, there wouldn't be a king. Look, I'm gonna be frank with y'all, because you seem like busy people. I'm just after that red glowy thing of yours. It looks magically powerful, and with it, I could probably send this world into a new age, an age of the wild. So, if you hand over your precious little red shiny orb, I'll be on my merry way.
Or you can just go about your merry way without it, because we're not going to hand it over to you.
Yeah, it's ours. So, bye-bye.
Yeah, how about no?
Andre just, like, waves.
Bye-bye. see you later. We don't really want to fight you. Or give you the orb.
Oh, that's so funny.
No, it's not.
You guys think you're going to fight me? I'm not going to fight you. Yeah. And he just goes, come out, dog! And the huge, burly man just bursts his way out of the fields. He just goes, that's my dog. I call him dog.
Okay. Weird.
Okay.
Dog's gonna fight you. For me.
No thanks.
Are you sure? Because I feel like you're in a place where you don't really have a choice. I mean, I'm
You know what?
I'm challenging the royal honor and the family. And if they don't honor my request, I mean,
listen. How about you call off your mutt and go off to where you came from?
Oh shit!
Design myself. I just kind of dig it here. The freedom, the lack of responsibility, the wanton murder and destruction, it's great. So, we'll make
it. Like, if Janice and Adelram became one. Janice, I'm sorry. Edit out me saying Adelram.
Janice hates this guy, by the way. Dude, you come in here stealing my look? Pathetic? And you're gonna come over and be an asshole? Dude! It's like, what the fuck? Rowan and Will are, like, about ready to stab him, by the way.
Like, go ahead. Yes, you guys, just like do it. We'll
continue on with our lives.
Rowan, just, are you sure? Like, okay. So, legit question here, as your dungeon master, are you just gonna let the Kenriths deal with this and like walk away?
Well, I mean, out of game, I have to get going soon. I don't want to make Rowan seem lazy, but at the same time, like, it's a good out for me.
I'll put it this way. Oko is true to his word. You can just leave, but he will try and take the orb from you.
Well, we can stop him from doing that.
I mean, you could try. So is that what you're gonna do? You're just gonna tell Rowan the world to walk away?
No, I'm not gonna walk away. I'm going to, this will probably be like the last thing I do tonight, but okay, so I'm gonna cast Charm Person.
Okay, I'm gonna make a Wisdom saving throw with advantage because he's fae. Yeah, that's a 19.
Not on him. Okay. On the guy who he was gonna have fight us.
Ah, okay. You do that, Rowan, and as you try, you get this, like, the best thing I can call it is, like, magical backlash. It's, you get the sense that you can't charm him because he's already charmed.
Man.
No normal guy of that stature would let a scrawny wimp like Oko call him dog. I'll put it that way.
You're right. That's correct.
So when you try to charm him, you like kind of get like your head shakes and you realize he's under a really powerful charm himself already. And Rowan and Will just kind of look to their four knights and they look at you and they're just like, all right, the four knights take formation and charge at this guy, and you all break into the woods, still running away. And that's how I'm gonna, like, make this work, because I do need you here for, like, 2 more minutes.
Okay. Because
you guys are very close to a lock. And you could hear the sounds of battle behind you, as Rowan will look very clearly guilty about the fact that they probably just sent 4 guys to die.
Yeah, yikes.
I know. I would have, like, stayed and fought them if I had more.
The thing is, I feel like Andre would stay and fight. Which is kind of conflicting, because the rest of the party is moving forward.
Yeah, Andre, would you want to try and tell them something?
You suck, bye!
Sari's very... It kind of seems that Sari's very much just like, I just don't want to fight in general.
Yeah, no more fighting. We did that. Been there, done that. I'm no more combat sessions.
And Rowan is a pacifistic person by nature and doesn't want to do this. So
this guy, yeah, honestly, not gonna lie, this guy reminds her too much of Janice, and she doesn't want to kill him.
So Andre, you could maybe like do something that isn't combat related as the party keeps moving to like maybe inhibit this a little bit. Like, you guys could like pot shot stuff as you run. That's a thing you can do.
Hmm. I'm looking through my stuff. That's not
helpful. I have a solution. Hmm? I have a solution if you guys are out of ideas, but I didn't want to immediately do it because I didn't want to fight your battles for you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But Janice has polymorph.
Oh my gosh.
Oh shoot.
Do it.
I think Janice would tell you, like, I could turn him into like a chicken.
Oh my god, please do.
Man.
Please. Please, I'm begging you.
Janice tried and it doesn't work on Coco, but it does work on the guy.
Ah.
So what happens is Janice casts the spell and this green light comes from his hands. Oko sees it and blue light comes from his, and the green light coils in his fingertips and just goes, you tried to polymorph me. I'd be impressed if I wasn't so ticked off. A shame. But, you know, in his distraction, the light hits the guy and he turns into a chicken with the same mask and huntsman attire.
I love it. It's
and
beautiful.
Oko looks at Janice and just goes like, You know I can dispel this, right? Like, this is a temporary... You guys suck!
You suck!
Fine, go to your Lady of the Lake. She will protect you. Whatever. Come on, chicken.
This guy, he's just such a, like, teenage asshole. Like, I'm not threatened by him. He's just a dick.
He picks up the chicken, throws a dagger, not to hit you, but just to, like, show how pissed he is at this whole situation.
He's just, like, an angry 18 asshole. Rowan's just like, I don't want to fight this guy. He's just an asshole. He's not worth fighting.
Janice looks at you and just goes, that better have been worth it, because I don't have high-level spells anymore. But, you all make the lock as you are, you know, as you keep trekking through, trying your best to, like, yeah, I'm sure that's not going to come back to bite us in the ass, you know?
It probably will.
But it's in that moment, you guys are like, you know it will, but you're trying to deny it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's fine. It's fine.
It's fine. Everything's fine.
And as you make it to this lake, we'll end on this scene. It'll not be long. Bubbling up from the waters of the lock is a red-haired, purple-skinned merfolk woman. And you will see her bright lime, like, bright yellow eyes as she looks at you. She has, like, purpley freckles on her, like, violet skin. She's actually very pretty in a cryptic siren kind of way. And her hair is, like, spray slit is very long, so as it hits the water, it, like, goes out along it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's all stretched out. She looks at you all, just goes, ah, I've been expecting you, travelers. Hello, my name's Emren. I'm the Lady of the Lock. I'm here to... Well, I suppose you know why I'm here. And I know why you're here, so I suppose we must get down to business, yes?
Yes. Yep. Right? Yes.
Janice nods and just goes, hey, do you got... Can you, like, pump some magic into this red circle by chance?
Like, that's what you can do. Sorry. This is a very funny way to say that.
She looks at the orb a little bit and just goes, can I bring it down into my lock? Yeah, cool. She pulls it under the water a little bit. And when it comes back, it looks significantly brighter. She's like, yeah, I've placed some enchantments in it. And you just hear Percy, Andre, for the first time in a while, just crawl up your shoulder and she just goes like, whatever that you just hear in your head, whatever that water lady did, tell her to keep doing that. That was fucking great.
Okay. Andre, like, kind of is startled by the voice in her head because she went a while without hearing it. But then she's like, okay. And then she turns to Emrin and is like, hey, that seemed to have a positive effect. Could you do that again?
After I'm done with what I have to do, you just hear Anna on it, like, ugh. And Caleb just kind of goes, well, what do you have to do? You people of Eldraine try to act so mystified by things that everyone just kind of knows. Of course the knights have a round table. Of course the creepy old lady making pies is evil. Everyone knows this. This isn't fucking foregone conclusions. I'm the Lady of the Lake. I provide magic stuff. I get it. Like, I know why you're here. Let's just cut to the chase. I've been around for ages. An endless eternity of giving rich assholes swords, okay? Like, and people try to act like, oh, a mystical lady. I know what I'm about, bitch.
Wow.
Rowan and Will are, like, giving each other the side eye of, like, oh, now you feel guilty, you know?
Uh-huh.
She looks up at the two Kenriths and is like, you two especially! Like, you're Prince and Princess of Eldraine. Of course you're here for my help. What, magic item? In boundless information? What is it? Just, what is it? They're just like, our father told us to come find you. Ah, yeah, sure, I had his thing on. Hold on. And she just, her head sinks into the water for a moment. You just hear from, like, the bubbles. No, no, no. Absolutely fucking not. You have, like, a half second to reel mentally from this. As she's looking for the gift for her.
More sassy than I imagined her to be.
Caleb looks to all of you and goes, like, do you get the sense that she's kind of, like, done with this shit?
I do. I really do.
She bobs out with, like, a grand white greatsword. She's just like, here, it's his. It's refined by the waters of Loch or whatever. He knows. He fucking does this yearly. This isn't special. This is his yearly checkup of magic sword. Rowan and Will are just kind of like, thank you? Don't sass me, Rowan. You just came over here last week to ask me about getting an enchantment on your sword. But it's... Yeah, but like... We thought you'd, like, want to be formally addressed and stuff. I don't care! I do swords! I get it! It's my job! Just let me do my job!
Oh my god!
And she looks to all of you and just goes, what? Do you... Yeah, fine. Do you guys want me to do swords for you?
I always don't. Like, lady, do you need a different job?
No,
You sound like you need a day off, sweetie.
I do swords. Like, I'm comfortable with my lot in this existence. I'm just sick of people trying to be like, I'm here for your help and boundless. You're here for a sword. If you go to the Lady of the Lake, you... Okay, like, let's just call a spade here. I'm not mad about it. Fact. But look, real talk, I knew you'd be coming here. Part of the reason why I'm so sick of this shit is because divination. So, like, I knew you were coming, and I already know what sword you're gonna get. So, like, let's just cut to the chase, so that way I can meet my next customer.
Sure. Yeah, let's do that.
Cool. Great. And she kind of looks at Andre and goes, you first. Since you have the deepest connection to my client, seems that you're a bit of a seer yourself, or at least learning to be.
Sure.
You commune with forces beyond this plane. It's obvious from the look on your face.
Oh, right. Yeah, that.
So, quite simply, I can take care of it for you. Don't get me wrong. I just wanted to address the fact that your don't look now, but your magic is showing.
Right.
I'm the Lady of the Lake. I can sense you.
Yeah, so, I just almost forgot I had it.
she goes, but for you, this path is marred by a life past shadow and a future that could be just as bright as the antithesis of the night. For you, she pulls underneath the water and pops back out with a sword that has two sides, one black and one white. For you, the sword of light and shadow seems correct.
Wielding.
Ooh. That.
Wield it well and make its name proud.
Okay, I will. Thank you.
You're welcome. She then looks to Rowan and she goes, and you, the spiritual healer.
Mm-hmm.
She looks under the water and just goes, give me a moment. And then she turns to Sari and just goes, your life is one constant seeking of joy, isn't it? You just want to make other people happy, don't you? You don't want to fight. You don't want to quest, really. What do you want out of life?
Is she asking me or Sari?
She's talking to Sari. She told me, she basically said, I'll get back to you.
Mm. Well, I don't know.
Well, I mean, it sounds like your story is yet to be written fully, but yet it sounds like you're ready to tell many tales yourself. For one such as yourself, and she pulls out a sword that has a purple side and like gray side. There isn't an image of this one because I had to make it myself, but it may be looking like this. For you, the sword of silence and song, wield it well.
Whoa.
Ooh.
I'm so glad I have sword proficiency.
yeah, it'll form into any sword that you actually can use. Keep that in mind. She looks to Caleb and goes, to you, the prince who is so far away from home. She sinks under the water and hands him a sword that has a fiery side and one that has cold ice, and the cold ice does not melt when touched by the fire. She just says, I am equipping you the needed means to survive the upcoming battles you'll face, but you yourself are not the one the sword belongs to. But she told me to let you hold to it until she's ready. So, for now, sword of fire and ice. Wield it well. Mm. Then back to Rowan. But you, you're not very appeased by the concept of a sword, are you?
I don't have sword proficiency.
You have scimitar proficiency.
Yeah.
But that is a type of sword, so it does work.
Oh. I was just trying to make a joke. Now I just seem stupid.
No, it's fine. But she just says, but yet, the fate. I work in mysterious ways. I do have a sword for you. even though it may not be ready to wield it the way that it's meant to be.
Okay.
And she pulls out a sword with green and light coming from it. The sword of body and...
Ooh, that's a cool sword.
She, like, picks it up.
As you pick it up, Rowan, that, like, a green light does kind of still glow in your hand, and it feels good. All of you have them. They feel good.
I never thought I'd feel good holding a sword, but gotta say, I feel pretty badass right now. She, like...
Emran nods and just goes, they were forged for you by the magic of the lake and fire of, well, I can't give away all my secrets.
Ooh, but secrets don't make friends.
They don't, but you're not going to be here much longer, are you? She sighs a little bit and just goes, but regardless, I do have one final favor. I cannot leave this world. I am bound to Eldraine. You are not. I can sense that. So, do me a favor. And she hands you a sword that doesn't have a glowing light from it yet. It looks like the other swords, but it's not, you know, it's not glowing anyway. It does have the signature two sides to it. It's a dull blade. And she says, it may not look like much now, but in the right hands, it'll be a powerful ally. My quest to you now, when you return home, you need to find those hands. This sword does have a wielder on it, and they will be a powerful ally in the days to come.
Mm.
You must find them. And when you do, the sword will be ready, and it'll glow, and it'll be welled, and only then will the person who deserves it be ready to wield it. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. If this blade falls into the wrong hands, it will not be anything more than just a cut and dry piece of metal. But in the right hands, it'll save your lives one day. I can see that from here. So, do yourselves the favor. Find its proper owner. And when you do, well, you'll know. She kind of gives you a wink, turns to Rowan and Will, and says, your time with the Kenriths is over. I do sense danger in its way. You've made a powerful ally today, and some powerful enemies as well. Your time in Eldraine is not yet quite complete. It is time for you to make your return journey. She grabs the red orb and pulls it under the water one more time. Near ready to go now. Almost at full charge. She hands it back to Janice and just goes, you are not a sword wielder. You were not, quite honestly, there was no expectation for you to be here, but it seems defying expectations natural state in life. Janice just kind of chuckles. But whatever, in this case, maybe. Be there for these people. They will need friends. And she kind of smiles to all of you and just says, all right, now that my spiel's over, she kind of stretches out her back a bit. Real talk, though, you might need to brandish those swords pretty soon. There's some pretty nasty shit coming. And you hear that familiar growl as that huntsman, no longer a chicken, starts. And Caleb just kind of goes, you wanted to give us these swords now so that way we can beat the shit out of this guy soon, huh? Emran just kind of shrugs and just goes, I'm just the lady of the lake. And that's where we're going to call the session.